Okay, so Evo Gen Videos made a video concerning this very same topic just last week. I had been planning on doing this one all month. But go check his out because his took a completely different turn than mine and probably went into a lot more detail than mine will in certain areas because it was a debate with a different person. I find it encouraging that more people are using and citing scientific papers to back up their positions. Because of the rise of the internet and the freedoms of information, the skeptical community seems to be growing, and that is causing people to wish to be more certain of their claim and use the tools science provides. Sadly, many people are not trained to actually translate scientific papers. There was a debate on Facebook I had recently with some vegans. I don't want to get into the subject of veganism in the comments section, and anyone who tries to convert me in the comments section might get blocked because this video is on science and not veganism. The claim that this fundamentalist vegan was trying to make was that humans are herbivores. He was not the original poster, just a friend of a friend. This chart showed the comparative anatomies of carnivores, omnivores, and herbivores. Human anatomy does show a lot more in common with herbivores than omnivores via this list. At first glance, it would look like, well, this means we're herbivores. Actually, this chart is misleading. We can't just use comparative anatomy with this because humans are quite special. We have a key ingredient that makes it impossible to use comparative anatomy: fire. Cooking has been shown to have unlocked a lot of nutrients available to any other animal. It allowed us to shrink our digestive tract and change our jaw and teeth setup. This redirected more energy into the brain. In a healthy human, 25% of all nutrients is sent to the brain. Homo has been able to use and harness fire, starting with Erectus and possibly Habilis. Fire is accredited by many scientists as showing a doubling in brain size. Prior to that, our driving brain growth evolution was caused by the evolution of amylase, an enzyme in saliva that allows for the breakdown of starch in tubers. Following that, our brain grew, and our ability to use tools, such as the ability to get marrow out of bones, opened up even more nutrients. These two new sources of energy moved us from Australopithecus, with a brain proportionally one-third of ours, up to Habilis, who had about half the brain size. So humans fit snugly into a new branch of eaters, the cooking omnivore. Our species is capable of gaining nutrients naturally from animal products. Herbivores live exclusively naturally on plants because they cannot digest or process raw animal-based products. Feeding rendered and processed meat to cows was just a bad idea, and while they could get nutrients out of the rendered meat, they also got mad cow disease. Go prions. Carnivores live exclusively on meat, unless they're sick. Cats, for example, require taurine found in meat, and they will go blind. To put a cat on a vegan diet without chemically synthesized taurine would be cruel. This is also assuming that the cat's body will uptake the non-natural taurine as well, which is its own study. Omnivores can eat and get nutrients out of both meat and vegetation. Whether animal products or plant products are healthier for you is irrelevant. The person arguing the case with me didn't know any of this and refused to accept anything I had to say unless I had a scientific paper to back it up. In any branch of science, if you're part of that field and things are common knowledge, you don't usually have to cite scientific papers. Scientific papers do increase your chances of accuracy, but many of these papers will reference books as part of their sources. A textbook or other books written by an expert in the field will suffice, which is why using jargon in your paper will give you better leeway when writing. This is because the use of jargon shows you went through the education process that everyone else in the field did. Telling someone basic taxonomy is not something you need a scientific paper for, just a textbook. I cited Catching Fire, a science book which is nothing but cite source, so he could go read it. He wanted links, of course, and refused anything less than direct scientific papers. He also didn't realize that scientists can use hair and bone to analyze diets of humans and animals, and wanted scientific papers as well. That would require the engineer's papers on building the device and specs, and it is a well-known technique in biology. He also made the claim that most hunter-gatherers were vegetarian and that Inuit only lived an average of 20 years strictly because they ate mostly meat, which would have nothing to do with the deadly cold and harsh surroundings. I'm sorry, but if you're going to go against the massive majority of the science community, the burden of proof is on you. You have to show us papers to back up your claims, and usually you don't know enough of the basics to do so. I was going to say this is just like a creationist, as Evogen Videos did, but I think it's now Godwin's second law. Instead of comparing someone to Hitler, you're comparing them to a creationist. He also claimed that bacteria from eating meat killed more people than HIV, which meant that humans couldn't eat meat. You can actually eat raw meat, sashimi and steak tartare, for example. These are high-quality cuts that have been tested for bacteria or have techniques that allow them to test a few because the technique is so reliable. The main reason why meat is so dangerous is fecal contaminants. Most of the low-quality meat is on the outside where the fecal bacteria contamination is most likely to occur. These must be cooked, but are still completely edible. I also had to tell him that vegetables have to be tested for almost all the same contaminants because we used animal waste as fertilizers, and many times the water used to water the crops is low-quality water that can be contaminated. All these E. coli outbreaks in the U.S. have occurred mostly on vegetables. I'm glad that many people are becoming more and more skeptical, but be careful when you take on a major topic. One of Carl Sagan's rules for skeptics was, do not go beyond your level of competence. Only argue the areas you are trained in. Do not try to argue quantum physics if you don't study the same amount in the field. This doesn't mean to stop questioning, far from it. But if you're discussing a topic with someone who's a trained expert, or more of an expert than you are, use that time for learning, asking questions from them, so you can find out if any of your ideas hold merit, as opposed to strongly holding the position that you are right until they prove you wrong. You could end up making very basic mistakes that make you look unskeptical while you continue to be certain and call yourself a skeptic.